Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to have you here today. We've got you in here safely, and we're hoping that we stay in the orange so that we can continue to meet. I don't know what's going to happen in the weeks to come. The infection seems to continue to grow, so I will not be surprised if they shut us down, but hopefully we won't. And are there any announcements that I'm unaware of or that we didn't talk about in the bulletin? I know that Santa Claus is not happening here, and we're looking to have a family candlelight service, but we're working towards that on the eve of Christmas Eve, the night before, for half an hour. And we'll see how things are when we get closer to that. We'll definitely tape something and put it online for those who can't come if we are not allowed to do that. But I want to look towards doing something. And the Lions, you put that on the site. When is that telethon or the?
The telethon is this Saturday coming.
This Saturday coming? This Saturday comes a telethon up at the hall in Penfield. And so if you want to contribute or help out or do something there, talk to Karen or other people, I guess. Let's pray. Father, it's good to be in your house. Lord, we want to talk about comfort today, comforting each other and being a comfort. We want to talk about how you might guide us to do these things in the lives of those around us, not only in our faith family here, Father, but in our communities. Father, we want to worship you, lift our prayers to you. We want to glorify you with all that we think and say and do today. And so, Father, you are welcome in this place. Be with us, guide us, speak to us, fill us, send us. In his name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. I want to open by singing. I'll open with singing a hymn. And as you read in the bulletin, you're not allowed to sing. And so please allow me to do that for you. Thank you. 1 Corinthians passage on true love, agape love, 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verses 4 to 7. Love is patient, love is kind, is not jealous. Love does not brag, it is not arrogant, does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account a wrong suffered, does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Please listen to these words. Amina Brown is her name.
He is here. In this room, in your heart, he is near, nearer than breath, heartbeat, nearer than you are to you, nearer than second chance or next opportunity, closer than tonight or yesterday. He is real, real than touch, see, hear, smell, or taste, real than reality. He is our reality, real than joy, pain, sorrow, real than the love of being in love. He is presence, like time, space, wind, silence, night. He is waiting. Creation, like words on the tip of tongue, like songs that have yet to be sung. He is beauty, oranges, blues, every hue, every shade, sunset and sunrise, whisper his name. He is holy, different, made human, became human, forgave human. He is spirit. He cannot be touched. His flames like sweet seconds of prayers, like a grandmother on knees, wood glow bare. He is sun, distinctly green, distinctly one, the only one. The only wise, the only resurrector of lives. He is king. No earthly throne can house. No amount of elegant words can espouse. He is moments and voice, power of choice, in word and deed, in root and seed. Pierced side, nailed hands, nailed feet, innocent wounds that bleed. He is belief and trust. He is enough. He is all. He is call and purpose. Everything that we can sacrifice, he's worth it and more. Our good deeds are mere pennies. We'll never even the score. He is revolt and wow. He is who, what, when, why, how. He puts on the show. He's the one we come to see. He is soul's cry and sinners flee. He is the epitome. He's the one no one can light a candle to or come up in a million foot pole of. He is above. He is a father's love. He is maker of ways, of earth and wind. Ancient of days, has no fear.
He is here in this place today, and he knows your name.
He knows my name.
Be still and know that He is God. Be still and know that He knows your name. And more than anything else, by His sacrifice on the cross, be still and know that He looks beyond your fault.
Thank you.
Gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the innermost being, and in the hidden part you will make me know wisdom. Purify me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence. Do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Let us pray. Father, we come before you in prayer this morning. And we believe, Father, as we lift our prayers to you, that the power of your wisdom, the power of your might, the power of your mercy and grace will fall upon those that we are praying for, and the blessings will return to us, Lord. And we praise you and thank you for that. I want to pray for Elizabeth Kneebone, that you guide the hands of the surgeons, the nurses, the technicians, all involved in her care and her surgery, that you get every part of the cancer out of her, that you cause her to be healed and recover quickly, Lord. We pray for Al Sullivan. We know that the cancer has spread. Even though the hospital holds no hope, we still pray for the miraculous, Lord, because that is what you've called us to do. And then we will leave it in your hands. I pray for him. I pray for his children. I pray for Rana, and to help her to understand in whatever way she can, even though her mind is wandering, that you would never leave her, that you will hold her close to you. Father, I pray for those in this church here. I pray for Alice, that she has a good recovery from their surgery, cataract surgery, and that things continue to heal. She is a miracle child. You're a miracle, Lord, all the things that you have brought her through. I pray for others in the church, those that could not be here, wherever they are, that they would know that they are loved, that they will know that they were wanted here, that they are needed here, that we need to be with each other so that we might enjoy each other's company, love each other, and rejoice together. Father, I ask that you be with Karen and the telethon and all that will be happening as you create something for poor and those that have less fortunate. Father, will just your compassion reach out into our community and help in that endeavor. Father, continue to bring people into this building on the hill in Beaver Harbor where the church resides. For we are the church, we are your people. Father, I ask as I start to speak about comfort, that people will not hear my words or my illustrations, but that they would hear your voice, Lord. Holy Spirit, will you speak into each heart and each mind? Will you give to them what they need to leave here with today, Father? May we be blessed by your presence, by your direction, by your wisdom, and by your love. And we will thank you in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Amen. People need people. There's no doubt about that. Lori was about 3 years old one night when she called down to her mother and said, "Mom, I need some help to get dressed." Her mother yelled upstairs and said, "Now, you know how to dress yourself. You don't need me at all." She responded to her mom and said, "Yes, that's true, but sometimes people need other people, even if they know how to do things by themselves." And that's true. And the question I would have for you today is this: What is it that burdens you? Think carefully. What is it that weighs you down? What is it that consumes too much, far too much of your time and robs you of the life that you could be living right now? Is it the worry of the pandemic and everything that it carries? Separation, isolation, rules, segregation, restrictions, loneliness, emptiness, frustration, even anger, and the list goes on. Is that something that burdens you down? Is it the missed goodbyes? Is it the lost memories? The face on the other side of the glass, or the face you see in the mirror? The truth is that we have within us the strength to endure, the strength to overcome, the strength to rise above, and the strength to even heal, given enough time. However, we need something more, something tangible in our lives, in our comfort. We need a hug. We need a kiss. We need something audible, like a voice, a song, or a laugh. Something tangible, like a hug. Something that we can see, like compassion, or a gift, store-bought, or homemade. It really does not matter whatsoever. The truth of all this is that people need people, regardless of what's happening around us. There's a poem by Benjamin Zephaniah that reads this way and sort of lets us know about people needing people. This is what he says. People need people to walk to talk to cry and rely on. People will always need people. To love and to miss, to hug and to kiss, it's useful to have other people. To whom to moan if you're all alone, it's so hard to share when there's no one there, there's not much to do, when there's none but you. People will always need people. To please, to tease, to put you at ease. People will always need people. To make life appealing, to give life some meaning. It's useful to have other people. If you need a change, to whom will you turn? If you need a lesson, to whom will you learn? If you need to play, you'll know why I say people will always need people. As girlfriends, as boyfriends, from Bombay to Ostend, people will always need people. To have friendly fights with and share tasty bites with, it's useful to have other people. People live in families, gangs, posses, and packs. It seems we need company before we relax. So stop making enemies and let's face the facts. People will always need people. It's true. People will always need people. 2 Corinthians verses 1. 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 to 7 reads this way. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also are the comforts is abundant through Jesus Christ. I like how Eugene Peterson put it in his translation, The Message. He says this: all praise to God and Father of our Master, Jesus the Messiah, Father of all mercy, God of all healing counsel. He comes alongside us when we go through hard times. And before you know it, he brings us alongside someone else who's going through hard times, so that we can be there for that person just as God was there for us. We have plenty of hard times that come from following the Messiah, but no more too than the good times of his healing comfort. We get a full measure of that too. The little girl at the beginning of the message did not need help from her mother to get dressed. She was more than capable, but there's something else that she needed. And ultimately, her mother gave her that, and that was a comfort. Comfort to know that her mom would be there for her. Comfort to know that her mom would be there to guide her if need be. Comfort to know that her mom's physical presence was there by her side. Comfort from hearing her mother's voice, and comfort, most importantly, from sensing and feeling her mother's touch. Knowing all this, showing comfort to others sounds like it shouldn't be a hard thing to do at all. I don't know if you would agree or not. But you need to understand this, perhaps. There's more to being comfort to someone. There's more giving comfort than just saying something like, "You can do it, and I'm there with you." I have been in countless hospital visits. I have held countless hands as they died, too many for one human being. And I have taken people from church and other people in to visit. And try as they might, they couldn't find the words of comfort. Was it the sign of a person wasting away from cancer, or the tubes, or the machines, or something too close to home? I don't know what it is. But sometimes it is difficult to comfort, even when you want to do that. It's very human, very human. It's hard enough to identify the real physical, the hidden psychological, or the veiled spiritual problems that some people have so that we might comfort them. For those of us, though, that call ourselves Christians, followers of Yeshua, comfort is something that we should feel obliged to do, compelled to do. Even if we don't have the words, we should find something, some way to comfort people around us. Before we strap on the armor of God, before we get on our trusty steed and attempt to comfort another human being, there's some things that we need to understand. We need to first understand the sources of the tribulations that we're going to face. Each person, each situation, each approach is different. It is unique, and it requires some prayer and thought on your part, rather than just rushing in to do what you think is right. If we find ourselves with someone for the cast of their arm, for instance, and we might say, it might be easy to say, "Hey, that looks like it hurts, and I'm sorry that you broke your arm, and I hope it gets better soon, and can I do anything to help you while you have that broken arm?" Well, that sounds like comfort to a person, and it may well be. But shouldn't we first step back and try to take a survey of the land? Give this some thought. Take a look at the cast. Has anyone written anything on the cast? Any names, any pictures, any hearts? How did this person break their arm? Was it an accident, or was it abuse? Can this person continue to work with a broken arm? Are they going to have problems financially? Are they going to struggle with other things in their lives? Are they going to be able to deal with pain management? Are they going to be able to afford things that they can take so they would have pain management? Do they need to talk to you? Or do they need you just to listen? See, it's easy to say, "I want to comfort somebody." And we should. It's easy to rush in and say, I'm sorry about that. Can I help with this or that?" But just like the cast, sometimes we need to take just a moment to take a look and think and let God lead us and speak to us and try to discover what's happening. A little girl came home from a neighbor's house where her little friend had died recently. "Where do you go?" her father asked. He said, "I went over to comfort her mother. He said, how were you able to comfort her? She said, I went over, I climbed up in her lap, and we cried together. We can comfort, or we can be a comfort. And saying a broken arm looks sore, and is there something we can do about that? Is something, you know, that's a comfort. Climbing into a lap and crying, that's being a comfort. Let me say that one more time. We can comfort or we can be comforted. And saying a broken arm looks sore, can we do something? Can comfort, but climbing into a lap and crying is being a comfort. Psalm 23 and 4 says this. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Before we can comfort another, we must stop reminiscing about our own broken dreams, our own broken expectations, our own problems amongst whoever will listen to us and give us time. Leading with this kind of talk will just make the person you're trying to comfort look for a trap door to get away from you. It's as simple as that. If someone has lost a person they've loved by separation, by death, or by any other way, talking about your own loss is useless unless you can tell them how you were comforted in the loss that you experienced. You can only talk about your afflictions when it's appropriate, but only when you can share how you were comforted by another person, whether it be God himself, another Christian, or another soul that has been afflicted in the same way. Always remember this. It's not about you. It is about them. Do more listening than talking. If we are to comfort others, then we must first learn to understand and find the joy in our affliction. I've told you on many occasions of a woman that I knew who was in a church that I pastored who was dying. She died a couple weeks after this incident in the Staples store. And she came dancing up to me, telling me how God had healed her knee that had afflicted her for years and years, called her all kinds of pain and disability, and it was gone. And she knew she was dying. She knew there was nothing much that could be done unless God was to perform the miraculous. Yet within that, she managed to find the joy that God had given to her and to spread that joy to others. I am by no means telling you that you must be joyful in whatever is afflicting you today, whatever burden is on you today. I'm not saying that you have to stop, drop, and roll and be joyful in all of that. What I'm attempting to say is that if you're going to comfort others, if you're going to comfort others, especially if they're suffering something similar to what you have suffered, you must try to seek out the proverbial silver lining in whatever happened to you so that you can bless them with some hope. You need to be willing to share that with others with compassion and with the same love that we read in Corinthians. The late Colonel Sanders of Kentucky Fried Chicken was on an airplane when an infant started crying. The mother did everything she could. The stewardesses did everything that they could to quiet the child, but they could not. Colonel Sanders said, "May I hold the child?" True account. They let the colonel hold the baby. He rocked the baby gently, put the baby to sleep. When they were getting off the plane, other passengers came up to him and said, thank you so much for what you have done for us. Colonel Sanders looked at them and said, I didn't do anything for us. I did it for the child, for the baby. When the burdens of tribulations threaten to crush your soul, cast your burdens upon Jesus. and you will find rest. One of the most important things for us to do when we're trying to be a comfort is to first come to grips about what we would do if whatever was happening in their life was happening to us. What would we do if this person felt that their soul was being crushed by a certain situation, whether it be health or relational or financial or spiritual, and try to place that within ourselves? How might we react so that we can show some compassion and empathy for them? We've just entered back into the orange phase here in zone 2, which is all the way from Sussex to the border. And as such, all the freedoms that you've slowly gained over the last little while have been, the rug's been taken up from underneath us. So much so that we're not even allowed to sing in church and are limited to how many we can gather with. It's like you're a jack in a box. You ever know that? Right? And things are done, we're in isolation, we're stuck there, and all of a sudden the government turns the crank, right? You pop out, but now you have to pop out with a mask, and you're sort of happy with that. Then another hand comes and shoves it back in the box. Right? It's crazy. And you might smile, and you should, but there's a truth to that. It seems like every time we make some gain, every time we come out of the box, every time we have some freedom, someone's trying to shove us back in the box. For some of us, it steals our joy, but for some of us, we're unable to cope with that. We're unable to cope by being pushed away from our friends or pushed away from our loved ones or denied simple pleasures and freedoms. And that can be soul crushing for a few people. And while some of us may endure this more easily than others, we need to be empathetic towards those who are being crushed by the restrictions and by the rules and by the masks and by the loneliness. There is precious little you can say to a person that might lift their spirits or give them a sense of peace. For some will rage against the government, what the government's trying to do with their freedoms, rage against those who will come into their orbit, and in reality, whether they do it well or whether they don't do it well, they are only trying to look after your own health. They're only trying to protect you from death. Some people you will meet in your life, maybe in your family or in your church family, your faith family, are going to feel crushed. They're going to need comforted, but as you go to comfort them, they're going to lash out. You're going to get it right up alongside the head. They're going to be right up in your grill. There's no doubt about that, right? You're going to say something innocuous, something innocent, and you're just going to get it right there, full face worth. Why would they do that to you? The reason they do it to you is because they love you. And somewhere in their minds, they believe that you love them and will forgive them. Isn't it odd that it seems to happen that way? The people we're closest to, the people that we love the most, are the ones that seem to be lash out at us the most when something's going wrong, when they're in pain physically or emotionally or spiritually. When you go to comfort them and they lash out a little bit, just step back, because they're lashing out because they know you will forgive and love them. And you should do so, and that will be a comfort. This is the point in which we must do two things. The first thing is that we should love as God loves us, with an agape love, a godly love. What is that? We repeat it and recite it every Sunday morning. Let's do it one more time. 1 Corinthians 13, 4 and 7. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. Love does not brag. It is not arrogant. It does not act disgracefully. It does not seek its own. It's not provoked. It doesn't keep account of a wrong suffered. It doesn't rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices in truth, believes all things, right? Hopes all things, endures all things. Loves, loves, loves. Embracing this kind of love for another human being will be a comfort to them. If you love them with non-judgmentalness, if you love them with non-accusatoriness, I don't know if that's a word, if you give them unconditional love, not the love that says, I will love you if I get this back. I'll love you if this happens. I'll love you if you become this kind of person. We're talking about a love that is unconditional. We talk all the time about loving the unlovable and forgiving the unforgivable. And if we want to give comfort to someone, no matter how it is, that's the way we need to love them. Jesus says this in Matthew 11 and 28 and 30. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is comfortable, my burden is light. I love the way Eugene Peterson puts it in his translation, The Message. And this is what, these are the words that he puts in God's mouth. Are you tired? Worn out, burned out on religion. Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly, unforced rhythms of grace. If someone you know feels that their soul, their life is being crushed by the circumstances around them, especially all the things that might be forced upon them, then they need God's unforced rhythm of life. And if they need God with skin on him, then you are the ones that should extend to them the unforced rhythms of grace. What does that look like? What does God's unforced rhythm of grace look like? Longing to leave her poor Brazilian neighborhood, Christina decided that she wanted more. She was tired of the pallet she was sleeping on. She was tired of a wash basin instead of a sink. She was tired of the food on a fire, an open fire, rather than a regular stove. And she wanted to go to the city. She wanted more. She wanted to experience more. And so one morning, she slipped away into the city. It crushed her mother. Crushed her mother. Maria, her mother, hurried. She gathered up all that she could. She went towards the train station. Before she got that, she stopped at a drugstore. There was a little one of those photo booths, you remember those things? And she went behind a curtain and sat down and she took as many pictures as the money that she could afford. She took all of those pictures and she put them in a bag and she got on the train and she went to Rio de Janeiro where her daughter was. Now, she knew that her daughter had no education really, didn't have any employable skills. When she got to town, she went to all those places where those women of ill repute might hang out, where prostitutes, women of the night, ladies of the night would hang out. She went there, and every bar and every seedy place and every seedy hotel she went to, she left a picture. She stuck it up on a window. She stuck up on a door, and she stuck it in the corner of a corkboard, and she wrote a note on the back of each one of these things. Soon she ran out of money, and she had to go home, and she did. 2 weeks later, Christina was coming down the steps of a hotel. The life in her eyes was gone. The liveliness in the brown eyes were dull and ached. She'd gone from one bed to another. She ached for that pallet at home, but she knew she could not go back. She was strong-willed and she would just not give in. She thought that she'd gone too far and no one would love her. As she got to the bottom of the steps in this one hotel, her eyes started to sting, her throat tightened up, tears began to fall. She saw a picture of her mother on a corkboard by the door. She slowly went over and she picked it up, held it to her chest. She saw something on the back and she read. And this is what her mother had read or written. Whatever you have done, whatever you have become, it doesn't matter. Please come home. And she did. So today, are you in need of comfort, or are you wanting to comfort someone else in your life? Do you need to climb into someone's lap, figuratively or physically? Has God comforted you through another human being? Have you attempted to find some kind of joy or silver lining in your afflictions? Have you surrendered your burdens to Jesus when your soul feels like it's being crushed? Have you loved people in the same way that Christina's mom loved her? If we are to truly comfort someone else, hear me now. If we are to truly comfort someone else, then we must, in essence, muster up all the unforced rhythms of grace that the Spirit has given to you and pour that into the lives. Look into another's eyes and with your heart say, whatever you have done because of your burdens, whatever you've become because of your burdens, whatever you have said to another because of your burdens, it does not matter. Please let God's love and my unconditional love, my grace, bring you home to a place of peace. Peace. Let's pray. Father, we do want to be a comfort to those around us, not only in our family or in our church family, but Father, in our communities, at work or at play. So many people are burdened by the things that are happening in their life, and this COVID is just not helping at all. And when we go to comfort, as you call us to, as we should want to, help us to take a moment to pray, to seek your help, to seek your wisdom, to try to understand what's going on. And then with that grace, with that beautiful rhythm of your grace in our hearts and our souls, allow us to move forward. And not just comfort, but to be a comfort, as you have been a comfort in our lives. Thank you, Father, for this and so much more. Amen. May God be with you, guide you, teach you, comfort you, and encourage you until we meet again. Amen.